Thanks, Mark. I thought I'd do something a little different than what I normally do. More like everybody else, I have a PowerPoint program, but this time I thought I'd sort of show, have more of a show and tell, which I did, I think, last when I was in the third grade, but it's back. First, let me start by saying, I think there's no such thing as alternative medicine. I think if an alternative medicine works, then it's medicine, and if an alternative medicine doesn't work, then it's not an alternative. The issue is whether or not it's been studied to prove it, to support its claims. And often, unfortunately, in this particular realm, there is precious little, actually, in terms of good scientific study. So what I thought I'd do is, in my 15 minutes is to just talk about a trip that my wife and I made to the Cape May, New Jersey GNC Center about a year ago and tell you sort of how that played out. So we walked in and we asked the 25-year-old behind the counter what he would recommend for just cardiovascular health, for health support, heart support. And he pointed to this product, which is vitamin E. Okay, now, if you look on the front of this product, it says Natural E 1000. On the back of the product, it says that it is 3,333% of the recommended daily allowance, which is to say it's 33 times the recommended daily allowance. Now, if you open up the bottle, and this is right back, this is fun for me. If you take it out, you see this sort of brown gel cap, which is about the half the size of an almond. Almonds are actually an excellent source of vitamin E. But you would have to eat 1,650 almonds to get what's in that one gel cap. Begging the question, why is the word natural on the front of this bottle? There's nothing natural about that. And in fact, if you look at studies with people who take large doses of vitamin E or vitamin A or beta carotene, which is an A precursor, or selenium, you actually increase the risk of cancer and heart disease because you can get, it's actually possible to get too much in the way of antioxidants. You know, antioxidants, you need oxidation. You can switch the balance of antioxidation, oxidation, too much in favor of antioxidation. You need oxidation to do things like kill new cancer cells, which you're probably generating far more frequently than you'd like to know. And so it's not surprising then that taking mega doses of an antioxidant can actually hurt you. But I think few people know that, even though the data are clear. In the medical literature, it's referred to as the antioxidant paradox. If you ask the 25-year-old behind the counter, is there anything he could recommend for lowering bad cholesterol, so-called low-density lipoprotein or LDL cholesterol, he will point to odorless garlic. Now thanks to actually groups like the National Center for Complementary Alternative Medicine, some of these products are studying. This is one of them. There are excellent data showing that this product does nothing to lower LDL cholesterol. On the other hand, if you have a history of heart disease, or you have had a cardiovascular event like a heart attack, you clearly benefit from statins like Lipitor. So if you're choosing to take this product, you're actually making a choice that can potentially hurt you. So to me, these are examples of when alternative medicine, if you will, crosses the line into quackery. The other thing, if you ask the guy behind the counter, is there anything you can do to help sort of shrink prostates that get enlarged? Usually men who are over 50 can have something called benign prostatic hypertrophy, which is the prostate enlarges and makes it more difficult to urinate. That can cause a problem with the bladder and kidneys. That can lead to sometimes fairly severe disease. He will point to salt palmetto, as he did when we were there. Again, because of NCAM, we have data showing that this product does nothing to shrink prostates. And there are products that are available, like Flomax, Ravidar, that can shrink prostate. So again, a choice to go to alternative medicine, which just seems natural and more benign. It's not big, bad pharma. These products are made by elves and old hippies on flowering meadows. And therefore, they can't possibly hurt you. They can only help you, but that's not true. Now, I'm gonna sort of set, I think, Dr. Edwards up by doing the following. When I first wrote this book, actually, the title that I had was Quacks, How They Hurt Us and Why We Let Them. I changed that title to The Sense and Nonsense of Alternative Medicine because I think there is some sense to this. And it's in, I guess, the so-called placebo response, for which I wish there was a different word. I think when people hear the word placebo, they think that that's a dismissive word, that it's just sort of all in your head, that it's just psychological and not physiological. But in fact, I think there is a physiological basis to placebo medicine. And I'll give you one example. So a few years ago, I had surgery on my left knee, which was microfracture surgery, which is a fairly complex surgery for which the recovery is about a year. It's fairly painful. And so my University of Pennsylvania sports medicine orthopedist recommended that as I was recovering that I take chondroitin sulfate and glucosamine. Now this also has been studied and does actually nothing for the pain of osteoarthritis. But that doesn't mean it was a bad recommendation. I mean, if I had walked that, if I hadn't been such a jerk and actually looked up to see the studies in places like the Archives of Internal Medicine, the New England Journal of Medicine, that there is no value for this above placebo, that I would have then, I therefore denied myself the capacity of the placebo response. Because although this product doesn't work any better than the placebo, it doesn't mean it can't work as a placebo. And there are studies, and had I taken this, believing it was going to work, it is possible that I could have learned to release my own endorphins, which are these chemicals that are made by the pituitary and hypothalamus that have sort of an anti-pain effect. And there are many studies actually showing that people can learn to release their own endorphins in some ways in association with acupuncture. So I think this is, I wished I hadn't looked, I wished I'd actually gone there and spent, actually it's not a small amount of money to buy this. This was about a $150 trip to the GNC Center, but you know, I think I had denied him the placebo response I'm going to argue he was trying to offer me. The other thing is the Himalayan sea salt powder. Now let me explain this to you, because this is a story of my daughter actually goes to Penn, this is why she never comes to my talks, because I'm terribly embarrassed. But my daughter last year was a senior at the Agserman High School, and she's a crew member, so she was in a boat that was pretty good. They made it all the way to the Nationals. But what would happen to her is in the before the race would start, often she would get this sort of tingling in her hands and feet, which her crewmates convinced her was exercise-induced asthma, which it wasn't, and that her parents should write her a prescription for a bronchodilator, which she wasn't going to get. So instead, what my wife did is she went on the internet and ordered this Himalayan sea salt powder. So with this, it's a blue canister. It sort of has holes on the top. If you open it up, it's got these sort of crystals, these salt crystals on the bottom of it from the Himalayan mountains. So the next morning, she's sitting there at the breakfast table, and she's reading the box, and this is going to be great. I mean, it's from the Himalayan mountains. It's from formations that are hundreds of millions of years old. This is going to be great. I looked at her and I said, do you really think that the sodium chloride in this preparation is any different than the sodium chloride in that salt shaker? And she looked at me and she said, would you let me believe in something, damn it? You know, I think she's right, you know, because if I say nothing, I again was a more reasonable person that said nothing. So then what she does is she inhales this, believing this is going to work, believing this is going to make a difference. And now she's more relaxed. So when she goes she doesn't hyperventilate, which is probably her problem, that she was getting nervous and hyperventilating, but this is going to convince her that she doesn't need to be nervous, and then she doesn't have the tingling, and then she's a believer. And unfortunately, I think that's the part of this that worries me a little bit. It's you know, she would then come out of this believing that there's something about salt formations from the Himalayan mountains that makes the tingling get better, when that's really not it. And so you sort of cross over into the line of magical thinking. And I think that therein danger lies. I think our path forward is through trying to figure these things out scientifically, and I don't think we should leave that. I'll sort of make one last point and then turn to Dr. Edwards. There was Mehmet Oz, who is my personal go-to person for healthcare advice, I don't know about you guys, but his show, the Dr. Oz show, he actually, to his credit, had a skeptic on the show named Steve Novella. I don't know if you know him, he's great, he's a neurologist at Yale, he has a blog called A Skeptic's Guide to the Galaxy. It's wonderful, actually. He has the capacity to explain science simply. And so he's on the show, and he's talking about acupuncture, and he's trying to make the point that although some people clearly do benefit from acupuncture, the question is why? What is it about that therapeutic interaction that is therapeutic? I mean, do you really need to put needles under the skin? Is it just because you're lying down, you have somebody talking to you in a calming manner, you're listening to music, you're smelling incense, whatever it is, because there are studies done, for example, by people like Esther Ernst at the University of Exeter, and England showing that retractable needles seem to work just as well. It doesn't matter, or other studies showing it doesn't matter whether you insert needles randomly or you insert them in these pre sort of prescribed points that were identified in the 2nd century BC in China. And what Dr. Oz said that I thought was so upsetting was he said, you know, there are just some things you can't know. That's not true here. This isn't a religious issue. We're not asking how many angels can dance with the head of a pin. You're asking, what is it about that interaction that's therapeutic that is knowable? You may not know it yet. It may not be easy to know it, but it is knowable. And I think that's the one plea I'm trying to make here, which is that I don't think we should leave the science. And I think at some level, the alternative medicine community, I think it survives, or not survives, but thrives, in part because they appeal to that sort of mysticism, that sort of otherworldliness, that this is something beyond conventional medicine, beyond Big Bad Pharma. And it's just, I think Andrew Weil, appeals to that, as does Deepak Chopra, Lynette Oz, I think they all do. I mean, there was a New Yorker article about Mehmet Oz a number of months ago by Michael Spector. I don't know if any of you saw it. It was great. And I think one thing it was said, and I'll close with this, was that as he was walking to the studio, he's just godlike to some people. He's a guru. And I think therein danger lies also. People just wanted to touch the hem of his coat, to sort of stick to the New Testament analogy. So I think we just need to stick to the science. That's the part I'm trying to take a plea for. But thanks for your attention. I'll turn it over to Dr. Edwards.
So thank you, Martha, for inviting me to come to this really fascinating format. And thanks, Paul, for sharing your perspective. What I'm going to try to do is really not take the defensive posture. I'm simply going to give you the commentary about what the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine is all about, how we do business, and give you a couple of examples of studies that we fund, and then we can open it up for questions. So as a matter of record, since I'm a federal employee, I have to let you know I have no conflict of interest, nor any financial disclosure. So I already told you what I plan to talk about, just giving you a little bit of insight on our mission, our research priorities, and also the work that we've been doing to educate not only the public, but also the scientific community. So we are part of the NIH, and NCAM, this is the acronym for it, was actually created by legislative mandate in about 2000. And partly in response to the increasing use of of those practices and also some concern about safety. So NCAM was created, and for the first perhaps 5 or 10 years, the philosophy was let a thousand flowers bloom. So we were accepting a lot of applications, perhaps not with a very strong focus. But I want to tell you that there has been a strong evolution of the way that we do business in the past 14 years. So our mission really is we want to define through really rigorous science the usefulness and the safety of those practices. And the purpose of this, and as Paul mentioned earlier, is that we want really the science to help us make informed decisions, not only the consumer, but also healthcare providers and also policymakers. So from that perspective, we completely are in agreement. I mean, we actually support really plausible research projects. And so the way that we do business is that we actually, for implementing our strategy plan, we stay very close to this framework of priority setting. In order for a project to be funded by NCAM, it has to hold scientific promise. The hypothesis has to be plausible. Second point is that you have to have methodology that would allow you to actually do the research. The third point is that it has to actually be able to be integrated into healthcare. And the fourth point is that it has to be relevant. So we really want to study things that would allow us to actually have potential impact for any unmet needs. So an example of this is that currently we're very much in a partnership with the Army and the Department of Defense to really look at the use of complementary and integrative health in the context of helping the military population. On the news again yesterday, there was this unfortunate incident about a PTSD individual that actually caused quite a bit of harm. And we're actually looking actively as different approaches, including meditation or other mind and body approaches that could actually help this individual in conjunction with pharmacological practices. I'll just give you a little bit of demographics and cost of complementary and alternative medicine. Now, this is data from the National Health Interview Survey. This is a survey that's actually funded by the CDC in collaboration with NIH. And the 2012, it's done every 5 years. The 2012 is gonna be released this summer. But really, the data shown here pretty much stays the same. The percentage of people that use complementary approaches, hovers around 35-40%. It's widespread in most demographic groups. Women tend to be more interested in using those practices. There is a geographic distribution with the West being more open. It's largely paid out of pocket, so it's actually a big business. Unfortunately, it's not covered by a lot of insurance. And there is a greater use with people with higher education levels, which is kind of interesting. So I just want to just give you a sense of what we've been doing in the past few years. So first 10 years, we had we were looking at a number of possibilities, including body-based methods, some energy therapy, but we've evolved. And our portfolios really are under two major umbrellas. One is natural products, and the other one is mind and body intervention. And I'll tell you what those, and out of those portfolios, we really fund a range of research questions, from basic science to translational research, to efficacy study, and also to effectiveness research. So we're interested in understanding how those practices work, can they be studied in people, are they actually efficacious, and also can you actually study this in the real world? So we're interested in outcome and effectiveness. So just to follow up on the point that Paul made in terms of dietary supplements, so that falls under that's one category of natural products. And the point I want to make is that natural, it does not equate safe. And I really appreciate the discussion that you had about some of those various products. So what I've done was to actually go to one of our portal is providing information not only to the public, but also to the scientific community. And here is our herb and plants page, and this is saw palmetto. And here, actually, it gives you a little, a set of information, general information, but then it also tells you what the science says. And this is data from two studies that were funded both by NCAM and NIDDK, which is the National Institute for Diabetes, Kidney Disease, and the Office of Dietary Supplements. So on the left-hand side, this is a study called STEP, which is saw palmetto treatment study. And this was a randomized controlled trial with about 225 men that were about 50 years and older. And they were treated with saw palmetto, about 320 milligrams per day for a year. And here, what you see here is the index used by the American Urology Association. This is a global index score. And you can see that saw palmetto and placebo were pretty much that study, a few years later, NCAM again funded a much larger trial, about 435 men, with the dose about three times that of the STEP study. So this is the CAMAS study. This was a multi-center trial that was not a grant given to an investigator, but it was a cooperative agreement, which means that staff at the NIH had a very integral part in the study design. So again, the data is pretty clear that even at 960 milligrams per day, over the same period amount of time, palmetto and placebo, certainly there was no difference between the two groups. So this is the kind of information that we try to actually provide to not only the scientific community, but also to the public. Our website has been, provide a wealth of information. But I think what we've been trying to do now is to do a little more outreach. So I'm not in this right now, but social media is becoming quite interesting. And we do have quite a few Twitter chats. We have research blogs. And let's see if I can make this. So we also have a healthcare provider portal that provides a lot of interesting information. Dr. Griggs, the director of the center, has, along with myself and a lot of our staff, we do have frequent research blogs that talk about various areas of interest in the science that's involved. We have an integrative medicine research lecture series. And as I mentioned, we tweet. I've been learning. In fact, as I, before I started talking, I actually tweeted that I was about to talk at the Neuroscience and Society Seminar Series. I'll just give you a couple more examples. This is mind-body intervention. We've already mentioned acupuncture. There is a number of those practices that are rather popular. Some of them have more evidence than others. And we are very much interested in understanding how they work and whether they are efficacious. One thing I want to point out is that for non-pharmacological intervention, we are really very careful as to the way we encourage our investigators to design their study. So really, you really need to have studies that demonstrate that there is a clinically meaningful signal. Then you go to a refinement of your intervention, do some pilot feasibility study, and that is an iterative process before you go ahead and get funded to test whether it's efficacious. Finally, we have effectiveness, how does that work in the real world? And then dissemination. And this is a process that we actively engage in. And our investigators sometimes, there's a little bit of tension because they're actually not used to having hands-on approach like this. But NCAM is small, and our budgets are small, so whatever we fund, we want to make sure that it's done well and that the study design is appropriate. This is one area I'm sure all of you have seen, the Time magazine cover. Meditation, though, is one particular mind and body approach that we actually very much interested in, and we do have some very good researchers that are looking into the mechanism by which that occurs. I won't go into all the details, but this is a study by Justin Brewer at the University of Massachusetts. This is actually looking at some of the potential brain mechanisms, and in this slide, this is showing really that there is a deactivation of a particular set of region of the brain called the default mode network that actually is deactivated during meditation. And the regions that are involved in that network really are focused on self-referencing and cognitive control. So there is some good science that is being developed, that is currently being funded, not only by NCAM, but by many other NIH institutes, showing the potential of meditation. I'll skip all this. So Paul talked about the placebo, and of course we have funded quite a bit of work on the placebo response, especially trying to understand the neurobiology of it. But recently, we've also been engaged in a discussion of the potential of using placebo in clinical practice. Now, this is a bit controversial, And you know, we've had many debates at that particular workshop that we've had almost 2 years ago now, regarding whether or not it's ethical to use placebo in clinical practice, whether or not one can manipulate the placebo effect. We have an investigator at Harvard that actually has been doing some interesting study. And this is data from TED Capture, where he's actually done a randomized trial looking at open label placebo, meaning that there is no concealment. So the subject were actually told that they were going to get placebo. Those are people that suffer from irritable bowel syndromes. So this, the trial was actually two arms. It was a no treatment arm, and there was subject that received that open placebo. Now, lo and behold, placebo actually really showed significant clinical effect. And even on this is the poor side. So this is the composite index of global improvement for those subjects. Placebo is superior. Even for the secondary outcome, which were symptom severity and adequate relief, placebo again was significantly better. And quality of life, there was also a trend to improvement. So the discussion right now is, can this be replicated? Can this be replicated in other conditions? And is it really ethical to do this? And that would be an interesting discussion to continue. So what I want to say to you, the message that I want to leave you with, is that our goal at the NIH is really to pursue promising scientific opportunities. We want to use the state-of-the-art science to actually do rigorous research. And we're really interested in objective presentation of the data. So science-based medicine is what we are all about, and I'm happy to answer any questions and to discuss anything with you. Thank you.
It would be unfair to say that sort of alternative practitioners practice placebo medicine and conventional practitioners don't. I think we practice placebo medicine in our hospital all the time. When you come into our hospital, you encounter doctors in long white coats that have red stenciling on them. I mean, that matters. I mean, how one dresses matters. We don't wear t-shirts that say "Iggy and the Squirrels in the front." I think that probably wouldn't work as well. We have big machines that make interesting noises. That you go in there with an expectation of therapy and of having a positive outcome. That matters. I think when we give a patient medicine, we'll often say, "I really think this is going to work for you," which matters as compared to if you just say this may or may not work with you. I mean, the color of the pill matters, as it turns out. I mean, blue pills tend to be seen as calming. Red pills tend to be seen as providing energy. So I think we do practice placebo medicine. I think there's nothing unethical about that. I think it's ethical to deceive, if you will, that sort of low cost, low burden, and in the safest way as possible. We do do that. So that's just one point.
But I think the point that you're making is that really it's the rituals. It's really the context that's important. So one of the I would say not a difference, but one of the particular aspects that one can experiences with a complementary and integrative health provider is that the time spent with the subject is much more meaningful. And so what we are finding, and some studies that we're finding, is that even in the context of behavior change, that complementary and integrative healthcare approaches seem to enhance not only the initiation of a behavior change, but also the maintenance of that behavior change. Again, it's that subject-provider interaction that seems to be important.
Yeah, one other thing, just to get, after I mentioned the term natural, I'm going to make a plea to do away with that word. I mean, I know that it's probably the biggest selling word out there, but You know, Ebola virus is natural, polio is natural. We just had a child in our hospital die from Streptococcus pneumoniae, which was a natural infection. We try and prevent a lot of things that are natural. And Dr. Edwards made this point, like, oh, just because it's sold as natural doesn't mean it's safe. And that's certainly true. And also, these products are, I think most people don't realize this, they're not held. The FDA doesn't regulate these products. I mean, what that means is that of the 54,000 dietary supplements on the market, I'm sure well less than 1% have any sort of reasonable safety and efficacy profile. And I think more importantly, as a minimum, many of them do not meet a labeling and manufacturing standard. And for that reason, Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, if you bring in a dietary supplement, if you bring in, for example, selenium, you know, 200 micrograms, we ask you to say, you really want to give it, we ask you to sign a waiver that says that we don't know what this product is. I mean, there's certainly a recent selenium product that instead of it said 200 micrograms on the label, it was 40,800 micrograms. So it's, I don't think people realize what it means to have an industry that's unregulated. A lot of there was an article recently about North American botanicals showing that oftentimes it wasn't the botanical that was on the label, sometimes it was rice powder or wheat powder, so when you study these things, you really wonder whether the next batch that you're getting is what you think it is, which I think is part of the problem with this industry.
So I forgot to mention that whenever a study is funded at the NIH on a natural product, whether it's a dietary supplement or a probiotic or any other botanical, we do have what's called a natural product integrity process, where the study is actually not allowed to begin until the investigator has provided the compound for NIH to actually verify the source and the composition. Right. So whatever it says it is, that's what actually is means.
That's great. Yeah. I can tell you the problem as it plays out for us, though. So for example, there's an interest by our oncology group to use milk thistle to try and protect against this sort of a liver-destructive phenomenon that are associated with certain chemotherapies. And so they've done a study to show that it may have some mild benefit. The problem is that if we want to use it, you know, there is no labeling or manufacturing standard that we can identify. Now, they did for that study have that, but you know, you're sort of stuck.
You know, granted that the education of the community is essential, but also the consumer needs to take some responsibility as well to research, to actually verify the information. So we're trying very hard through media outlets, through position papers that we put out, to actually spread the word. If there is something to be warned about, definitely we do the very best we can to do this.
Ready? Any questions?